So this is some work which I've done in collaboration with Federico Galli, Juan Hernandez, Rob Myers, Xianming Ruan, and Joan Simone. And okay, so the main motivation essentially comes from the main topic of this workshop, so the crossover with quantum information and let's say the major progress that was achieved in understanding the role of entanglement and of entanglement measures in the context of holography. And so this type of developments have suggested a somehow new operational perspective on spacetime, meaning that they suggested asking questions about generating spacetime itself rather than only probing it with observables such as entanglement measures. And so this type of considerations have led somehow naturally to considering the notion of computational complexity in this context. As a measure of the difficulty of performing a given task. And so this type of quantity was suggested to be able to capture the growth of the Einstein-Rosen bridge in asymptotically aliased black holes, and was proposed somehow as a complementary quantity to the entanglement entropy in the perspective of trying to understand space-time geometry in terms of boundary entanglement. And so, in particular, we are interested in the notion of quantum circuit complexity. Which quantifies essentially how hard it is to prepare a given target state, psi t, starting from some given reference state, psi r, and so generating at least approximately this target state by acting with unitaries ut. And so these unitaries are built from the action of elementary gates, GI. Which can act on the entire system or on the circuit or on some subsystems. And which are drawn from some given set of operations and are built in terms, well, from Hermitian edge generators. And so, in general, there exist many such unitaries that implement this transformation, and then complexity quantifies the cost of the optimal circuit. And so a precise mathematical formulation of this type of procedure was developed by Nielsen and collaborators starting from 2006 in terms of a geometric approach. So the starting point here is to give a continuum representation of the unitaries U. So in terms of a right to left path ordered exponential. Where here S parameterizes time along the circuit. So let's say from 0 to 1. And this instantaneous Hamiltonian H is built in terms of the generators OI and these control functions Y, which count at each point of the circuit which gates we are applying and how many times. And so with this representation, U now defines a path in the space of unitaries, which starts from the identity, so from the reference state, and ends on the desired unitary that implements the transformation ut. And so then, then Nielsen defined the cost associated to these unitaries in terms of a cost function f, which depends on the position in the space of unitaries and on this control function y, which are the components of the tangent vector. And then complexity of the target state psi t is defined as the cost of the optimal trajectory. So it's the minimum of t. And so in this way, optimal circuits which generate the desired target state are mapped to globally minimizing trajectories in the space of unitaries, and the entire problem is recast into a classical mechanics problem with Lagrangian given by the cost function f. So the precise form of this cost function is not fixed, but usually one requires some basic properties, such as smoothness, positivity, and triangular inequality. And so one such measure that has been often used in the recent literature and which will be the main example of this talk is the so-called kappa equal 2 cost function. Which is just the sum of the moduli squared of these control functions. And so this quantity also it's also basis independent, so it does not depend on the choice of basis for the operators O, and that's not a property which is always required, but it certainly sounds like a desirable property. Okay, so this type of approach a la Nielsen in the space of unitaries has been extended to quantum field theories, starting from the work of Jefferson and Myers in 2017, where the basic idea there was to regulate the theory on a lattice, and then therefore reduce the problem to a system of coupled harmonic oscillators. And so this type of approach has allowed to study the complexity of a number of simple states, like the vacuum, coherent states, the thermofield double state, in free theories. And let me also mention that there are, of course, other approaches for defining complexity in quantum field theories, which were developed in parallel to this one, and actually by many people here in the audience. But for this talk, I will only focus on this type of construction. Okay, so again, as we know very well, There are two main proposals for the holographic duals to this quantity. Okay, so the first one, the volume conjecture, which associates the complexity of this target state psi t defined on some boundary Cauchy slice sigma to the volume of the maximal hypersurface B, which ends on the boundary on sigma. And then, okay, for dimensional regions, there is G newtons, and an arbitrary length scale, which has been often identified with the ADS radius. And the second proposal, known as the complexity equal action, which associates the complexity of the same target state to the gravitational action evaluated on the Wheeler-DeWitt patch. Or a domain of dependence of a bulk spatial slice, which is anchored on sigma at the boundary. And so again, and so the study of holographic complexity in the past few years, so sorry, I forgot to mention, this is the proposal of Stanford and Susskind of 2014. And these, so Brown, Roberts, Susskind, Swingle, and Zhao of 2015. And so there have been a lot of literature and efforts in trying to study these new gravitational observables, and interesting properties have been found. But at this point, there is still, the direct connection of these holographic proposals with the dual field theory complexity quantity is still not yet completely clear. In particular, while the target states have a clear geometric interpretation in terms of semi-classical duals of bulk fields, the implicit choices of reference state, of gates, and cost function are less clear so far. And essentially, the main strategy so far to try and to get some insight has been to compare these holographic findings with independent quantum field theory results in free theories. And in fact, some similarities have been found between these two type of quantities, for instance, in the structure of UV divergences. Which are found to be extensive in all in all three constructions, so the two holographic complexities and the field theory complexity, and which, for instance, at least for some choices of ingredients in the quantum field theory definition, and so that, for instance, have been reproduced by the main example here, so by the kappa equal to cos function. Okay, let me just stress, it is clear, but let me stress that this type of comparison, of course, it's limited by the difference in the regimes of applicability of the two computations. And it's also somewhat technically limited by the difficulty in keeping track of all the free choices that one can make in the definition of complexity. Thank you. So motivated by this type of observations, what we did was to consider variations of complexity. As we slightly perturb the final target state. Or said in another words, this type of variation allows to study what is the cost of perturbing spacetime. So in particular, looking at these variations allows to focus on the dependence on the target state and on its variations, which do have a clear geometric interpretation. And as we will see in a moment, it does allow to remove some of the freedom that we have in the definition of complexity. And then hopefully, by comparing with quantum field theory findings in a way that I will explain later, it should also allow us to get some information on these implicit choices that are done in the holographic proposals. Okay. So we consider variations of this type in which we keep fixed the initial reference state. And we vary slightly the final target state. Which produces a slight variation in the optimal trajectory. And so let me introduce coordinates xa on the space of unitaries, actually. Let's measure by delta xa the variation in the location by the endpoint. Using the analogy of Nielsen's approach to classical mechanics, is immediate to derive a first law for this quantity. Meaning that if we look at variations of complexity, the first order variation will be given by the product of the momentum along the original trajectory, Pa, which is the derivative of the cost function, variation on the endpoint position evaluated at the endpoint of the trajectory. And in situations in which these two are orthogonal, actually as the main example that I will discuss in a moment, this variation is still given by a contribution at the endpoint, and it's given by the variation of the momentum times the variation of the endpoint position. But again, here, the main important point of this simple expression is that these variations are evaluated at the endpoint of the trajectory. And so these, in principle, could allow to get rid of some of the dependence from the choice of initial reference state and geodesic path. And thus focus on the remaining cost function dependence of this quantity. Okay, as a simple first application, we studied this variation in a holographic setup. In which we consider as the target state the vacuum and the slightly perturbed target state is a small amplitude coherent state. let me start from the bulk description of this type of state. So we have gravity, negative cosmological constant, and a bulk scalar field phi. And one can work out these expressions in general, but let me just focus on a four-dimensional case with massless scalar field. So given the mode, well, the standard mode decomposition of this field in ADS, where n collectively labels the quantum numbers, we can consider an excited state, epsilon alpha j, which is obtained by acting with the displacement operator, which excites a few modes labeled by j. On the vacuum, in such a way that these few modes j are given a classical expectation value. Which we define as phi classical. And then what we do is to work perturbatively in the small amplitude of this classical field. So this was the bulk description of these states from the boundary point of view. These are still coherent states, and they correspond to excitations of the vacuum by the action of the dual generalized free field operator O, which in this case it's marginal, and its descendants. Okay, so this is a very simple observation. So the fact that these coherent states are coherent states in the boundary CFT and in the bulk. And it has two main consequences. So the first one is that at the technical level, instead of computing the complexity in the CFT, we can directly use the bulk. Well, since in ADS-CFT we have the same quantum states, we can use, in the boundary and bulk description, sorry. So we can use directly the bulk description of the states and compute the QFT complexity Allan Nielsen directly in the bulk, so for bulk fields in ADS. And we can do so by adapting slightly some results, which were already worked out by some of my collaborators, so by Guo, Hernandez, Myers, and Ruan, for coherent states in free theories. And at the same time, the fact that these are very simple states, which have well-known semi-classical duals, makes this type of setup very suitable for explicit holographic complexity computations. Okay, so let me come now to the results. A description of the results that we obtain. Let me start from the complexity equal action proposal. So for that, we use the action that was worked out by Lenaire, Myers, Poisson, and Sorkin in 2016. for a well-defined variational principle for a choice of Dirichlet boundary conditions on the boundary of the Wheeler-DeWitt patch. And so this type of action contains a number of terms, and the relevant ones in these computations are just the bulk term, a null boundaries terms, and a counter term action. So this is essentially just the analog of the Gibbons-Hawking-York term for null boundaries. And it measures how much non-affine the parametrization of that we are using for the boundaries is. And this third type of term, instead known as the counter term, instead is given explicitly in this way. So it's constructed in terms of the expansion scalar of the null generators of the Wheeler-DeWitt boundary. It's localized on the boundary, and it contains an arbitrary length scale, which has been suggested in the past to be related to the frequency, or let's say to a typical length scale in the choice of reference state. Okay. So we computed these variations for a spherically symmetric perturbation around MTADS. And as I was said, we worked perturbatively in the classical amplitude of this scalar field. So then the structure at leading order, which is the quadratic order, is very simple. So this variation contains two types of contribution. One contribution which captures the variations of the fields in the undeformed Wheeler-DeWitt patch. And another contribution, which captures the background fields in the deformed Wheeler-DeWitt patch. And so then, by explicit computation, one finds that, actually maybe a bit surprising, that all gravitational terms cancel each other, and that the full result is entirely given by the variation of the matter term. So essentially, everything reduces to a probe computation. So this can be evaluated explicitly, of course. Well, let me just write it. Okay, so let me just make a couple observations. So this is a purely order epsilon squared result. As I was saying, it's entirely given by the matter content. It's also localized on the boundary of the Wheeler-DeWitt patch. And let me also mention that even though I didn't show the details, so the presence of this counter-term action is actually crucial for the cancellation of the gravity terms. Okay, well, so now we can evaluate this quantity explicitly. And let me just point out like a couple of features of these results. So it exhibits some typical oscillatory behavior. And if we focus, for instance, on the t equals zero slice, so we can write this complexity equal action variation. in terms of some coefficients. So J here labels the radial quantum numbers of the excitations. And so this this entirely captures the variation, and it shows some typical J dependence. So it's actually dominated by the diagonal term, which decays for a large J as log J over J. And actually, I realized I also forgot to mention another general observation about this result is that it's UV finite. And it's also scaling dependent. So it means that there is no appearance, well, of the ratio, let's say, of the ADS radius and the counter term scale, which appeared in the action itself. Thank you, sir. Okay. Okay, so let me now come for the results for the volume. So the variation of the volume is entirely given by the change in volume of the background surface due to the deformation of the background. So this is essentially entirely given by the TT component of the bulk stress energy tensor, as was also found in other works like Belin, Leukovic, and Sarosi in 2018, and Jacobson and Visser in 2018 as well. So again, this is a purely order epsilon square result. It has the same oscillatory behavior as the complexity equal action, but with different amplitudes. But it also shows some very interesting differences with respect to the action, because, well, normally these two type of observables give compatible results, while in this case, this variation can actually be negative for relevant operators and low enough modes, which would suggest that these excited states, according to this measure, are actually less complex than the volume, than the vacuum itself. And at the same time, if we again look at this t equals zero slice of the result, and we capture the entire variation with these coefficients, so this is again dominated by the diagonal term, but instead of decaying at large J, it actually increases linearly. Okay. Okay, so let me finish with some more general remarks. Okay, so the fact that we find that both these holographic quantities are purely epsilon order epsilon squared in view of these general results for variation means that the let's say that the directions of these coherent states are orthogonal to the direction that prepares the vacuum. Equals zero. Then the fact that we find that the complexity equal action results fully localizes on the boundary of the Wheeler-DeWitt patch might be suggestive of trying to interpret the end of the circuit in the bulk as ending on this boundary. But this will need, of course, some further investigation. At a more quantitative level, as I was saying, we can follow the usual strategy and try to compare these results for holographic complexity, for these variations, which, as we said, are completely scale independent, with these quantum field theory computations for scalar fields in ADS. And so there, let me just mention that none of the measures, of the standard measures that are used is compatible with the variation of the volume, while there is some compatibility of the results with the variation of the, for the variation of the action, with the kappa equal to measure that I was telling you about before. So in particular, this is also a purely order epsilon squared result. It exhibits the same oscillatory behavior as the volume and as the action, but again with slightly different with different amplitudes. And also, if again we focus on the t equals zero slice and look at the large radial quantum number j, we have that these these coefficients are in fact purely diagonal. So in this simple measure, all coherent states directions are mutually orthogonal and exhibit the same decay as the one that we observed for the action. However, this full result is not scale independent as the holographic one. In particular, it depends on the frequency or on the typical scale that sets the reference state. It depends on a length scale of the background metric, and it depends also on a typical scale of the gates that produce this coherent state in the field theory. And so somehow comparing with these holographic results would require setting this scale, well, fixing these scales. And let me also make a more general comment that the fact that we find this scale dependence in the quantum field theory variations might seem to clash with the statement that this type of variations only depend on data at the endpoint. However, the fact is that this variation of the momentum, let's say, bears some memory of the choice of reference state and geodesic path through the scale, which is then manifest in the result. And okay, and I want to conclude. So the idea here was just to give a very simple example of a possible application on this first law or the study of these variations. And then the hope is that by studying further this type of quantities, we actually might be able to make a better contact between these holographic proposals and the complexity of the dual boundary state. Okay, thank you very much.